Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this morning on this blustery day. I'd say we were the frozen chosen, but no. Glad everybody is here and made it here safely today. Are there any announcements before worship today? All right, we have Kathy coming up.
On Tuesday, we were supposed to have a gathering of the women for our meeting for January 16th. We're going to cancel, and we're going to have it next Tuesday on the 23rd.
Good morning, everyone. Yes. Just a reminder that annual meeting of the congregation will be held on January 28th, Sunday, January 28th, 2 weeks from today. Please make an effort to attend that so we can take care of the business for the year coming up. And if anyone's interested in being on council, please see one of us council members or pastor and pray about joining the council. And thanks to Shelley for keeping us going with the computer and all of our new equipment that we have so far. And the rest of the equipment is supposed to come in February. Thank you.
Good morning. Just a couple quick things. We didn't have our breakfast yesterday on account of the weather, but we are doing another pork chop dinner in March. Tickets are available and flyers are available, so if anybody wants to buy the tickets or distribute the tickets, sell the tickets, and distribute the flyers, see me after church. Also, there's a Roman cabinet in the basement right underneath the coat rack downstairs here. If anybody's interested in that, just grab that too. It's free. And there will be a men's Bible study after church today. Thank you much.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our next raise rate order is due next weekend, and then they'll be here before church the following weekend. And we are collecting the change known as the offering for Sunday school today.
Any other announcements? All right, if there are no other announcements, please stand and we continue with confession. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, creator of darkness and light, word of truth, wind sweeping over the waters.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. God, our rock and refuge, we pour out our hearts before you. We have known you, but have not always loved you. We have wounded one another and sinned against you. We have not always recognized the Holy Spirit dwelling in each of us. Remember your covenant, renew your creation, restore us, that we might proclaim your good news to all. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. God has spoken. The time of grace is now. In Jesus, the reign of God has come near. By the authority of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are God's beloved.
Thank you.
God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eleazar of Damascus. And Abram said, you have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, this man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, look toward heaven and count the stars, if you are able to count them. And he said to them, so shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. Then he said to him, I am the Lord who brought you from Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. But he said, O Lord God, how am I to know that I shall possess it? He said to him, bring me a heifer 3 years old, a female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. He brought him all these and cut them in two, laying each calf over against the other. But he did not cut the birds in two. And when the birds of prey came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. As the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and a deep and terrifying darkness descended upon him. Then the Lord said to Abram, "Know this for certain, that your offspring shall be aliens in a land that is not theirs, and shall be slaves there, and they shall be oppressed for 400 years. But I will bring judgment on the nation that they serve, and afterwards they shall come out with great possessions. As for yourself, you shall go to your ancestors in peace, and you shall be buried in a good old age. And they shall come back here in the fourth generation, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete." When the sun had gone down and it was dark, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed between these pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, "To your descendants I give this land, from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates, the land of the Kenites, the Kenizzites, the Kadmonites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Rephaim, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Girgashites, and the Jebusites."
I can invite the children forward for a children's message. Are there any children for a children's message? Maybe not. All right, hi, how are you? I like your shoes. Come on down. How are you? Cold? Anybody cold? Outside? In here, it's nice and warm, isn't it? Yeah. Let's see. Today we heard a story from the Bible about somebody named Abraham. You ever heard that name before? No? Maybe Abraham Lincoln? Heard that name like that? Abraham was a person in the Bible, and he was 99 years old. What's old? What do you think is old? The older I get, the higher it goes. What would you say is somebody that's old? 20, 30, 40, higher? Higher or lower? Just tell me. 40, is that old? 50? It's old. 60? Old. 70? Old. 80? Older. 90? Do you know anyone that's 99 years old? No. You know, I know a couple people that are maybe right around or 100 years old. So he was an older person. So what do we expect if somebody's older? What do you think? They're probably pretty smart, right? Well, Abraham had a wife named Sarah, and they were both older, and they didn't have any children. And what do you think happened? God came to Abraham and told him that his descendants were going to be, you know what a descendant is? Kids and grandkids, great-grandkids and great-great-grandkids were going to be more numerous than the stars. Can you count those stars? Yeah, maybe if we say, like, if you were looking at this through a telescope, could you count all the stars in the sky? No. How about these? Could you count these? No. None of them, right? That's a lot of stars. We'd probably fall asleep before we counted all the stars. Well, that's how many kids, grandkids, great-great-great-great-great-grandkids that God told Abraham they were going to have. But wait, they're like 90 years old. Do you know any 99-year-old person that had a baby before? No, that would be in the Guinness Book of World Records, wouldn't it? Yeah, probably. And ouch, I can't even think of that in my age. No. So, Sarah and Abraham, God told them they were going to have a child. And guess what? They did. They had one child named Isaac. And What do you think happened after that? Did Isaac have any children? Yes. Did Isaac's children have children? Yes. And they had children, and they had children, and so on, and so on, and so on. So God made that promise to Abraham and Sarah that he would have more descendants than the stars, and they would have all this land, two promises. Does God keep God's promises? Yeah. Yeah, what does God promise us? You know one thing God promises us? Anything? Anybody? Yes, God promises to be with us. Is God with us now? Yes. Will God be with us tomorrow? Yes. And the day after that? Yes. And with us, everybody, more numerous than the whole universe? Yes. Always. So God keeps God's promises. He kept them to Abraham and Sarah and everybody else since then. So God keeps God's promises. That's great. God, thank you for keeping your promises and for promising to always be with us. When we look up at the sky at night and we count the stars, help us to think of you and remember your promises and your love. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, I got something for you. All right, I'll take one of these. And who wants to help with the noisy offering? Here, I'll hand that to you. Who would like to help with the noisy offering?
They all want to help.
They all want to help?
Yes. They just
here, you go. Okay. Here you go. There you go. Thank you. All right, we continue with the video.
Thank you.
My understanding is the sound should be much better once we get the new projector. So hang tight, it will get better.
It's the camera feed that is lacking, so I'm doing my best to hold it here. I'll try to.
Yes, thank you, Michelle, for everything you've been doing to keep our tech going. So we continue through the story, and this week we are in chapter 2, where God builds a nation. Now we are continuing through the book of Genesis, if you're following along in a Bible, and there are so many theologically rich stories in Genesis, even in this chapter about God building a nation. It's hard to pick just one. And unfortunately, I can't preach the whole gospel all at once. Shucks. So when we think of this narrative, when we think about Abraham and the Abrahamic covenant, when you think about Abraham, what is something that comes to mind for you? If you're going to talk to someone about Abraham, what immediately pops into your mind? Being a father, sacrifice, that's a huge part of this narrative. And being a father to many, many descendants, when he would have two children of his own. So Abraham was a man of God, getting on in the years. To us, we think of somebody in their 90s. We're not imagining them starting a family at that point. Well, Abraham and Sarah did not have any children, and God had come to Abraham and told him, you're going to have more descendants than the stars, more than the grains of sand. Really? And Sarai, at that point, was barren for a number of years, so they really didn't think it was going to happen. So Abraham's first child actually was with Hagar, who was Sarai's servant, and that son was Ishmael. And then there started getting some bad blood between Sarai and Hagar, and Ishmael and Hagar were sent out. They went out into the wilderness. Some years had passed, and then Isaac would be born. Do you imagine having a baby in advanced years? How challenging that would be. So they have this baby, and the child is growing up, and God asks Abraham to do the unimaginable. Take his only son with his wife, Sarah, and go and sacrifice the child. Be prepared to give up the child. So Abraham does as God says. He's a God-fearing man and takes him up to be sacrificed. And right at the last minute, God provides sacrifice. But Abraham was willing to do that much. And it makes us think about the times and ways God asks us to sacrifice something. What has been the most difficult, challenging thing that you have ever had to give up? Any answers? What has God asked you to give up? Maybe you've been in a job that was morally questionable. Maybe you found out your company was doing some shady dealings and you had to leave your job that you knew and loved. Maybe God has been asking you to give up something that you are doing personally that is not good for your body. Maybe it's too much sugar. Maybe it's some addiction of some sort. Maybe God has asked you to give up some idols in your life that are coming between you and your relationship with God. Something you are idolizing, whether that be, you name it, social media, sports, whatever the case may be. There will be times when God asks us to give up, to sacrifice something. Is this a test? Does God test us? What do you think? Does God test us? Ooh, I'm going to get her. She's going to have to do this. Does God do that? Does God allow that? Yes. Think about Job, right? How tested and tried Job was. We are tested by circumstances and things that happen and natural consequences from behaviors that we have, right? There will be trials in our life. But what if we looked at those not as a test, but as an opportunity to grow? To grow in relationship with Christ. To grow as a Christian. To become more Christ-like in whatever God is asking us to give up. We can do hard things. We've all had to do some hard things. What are some of the hard things you've been asked to do? Maybe a hard thing was taking your child to college and leaving them there. Maybe a hard thing you've had to do is to sit at the bedside of a dying parent. Maybe a hard thing you've had to do is to leave that job. Or to call out a friend on their behavior. Maybe a hard thing you've had to do is to give up something that wasn't good for you. But we can do this only with God's help. And God promises to be with us always. Maybe you've heard the only way out is through. There's some truth in that, right? That we get stuck in the middle of a life mess, and you just gotta keep going through. With God's guidance, with God's direction, with God's kick in the butt, with God's help, we can do that. We don't always see the fruit, right? Abraham was going to have so many descendants. Did he get to see all of them? No, eventually he would die. That was Isaac and Ishmael. But it was really through Isaac. We would have Jacob and Esau and the stealing of the whole birthright thing. Jacob would have the 12 sons, right? 12 sons, which would become the 12 tribes of Israel, which would keep multiplying and multiplying. So Abraham trusted God, went where God told him, directed where God directed him to go with faith. And even in his advanced age, trusted God, willing to sacrifice his son. And all of that would come to fruition. God keeps God's promises. God's promise to us is to be with us. And through Jesus, we have the promise, the hope of eternal life. And it's through that line of Abraham that eventually would come kings. And we know Jesus, right? So we give thanks for our ancestors, for God's presence with and among us, and for the ability to do hard things with God's help and by God's grace. Please stand.
Mm-hmm.
suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
As we celebrate Christ embodied in human form, we pray for God's blessings on the church, the world, and all of creation. Encourage the ministry and mission of the church. God of truth, let the leaders of your church be trustworthy and accountable stewards, that all its resources and outreach bring hope and healing to communities. God of grace,
receive our prayer.
Delight in the goodness of your creation. God of fig trees and fertile soil, heal areas of the world harmed by human greed. Restore those recovering from natural disaster. Protect our forests and waterways and all the creatures that live in them. God of grace,
receive our prayer.
Call the leaders of every neighborhood and nation to serve faithfully. God of wisdom, give them visions of justice and unity. Lead them to action that promotes equitable partnerships and uplifts those on the margins of society. We especially pray for service member Anthony Church. God of grace,
receive our prayer.
Hold in your care any who suffer and struggle. God of compassion, you who know our inner hearts, be present with any who are oppressed and all who long for respite or restoration, especially Jeff Flood. God of grace,
receive our prayer.
Trusting God, who raised Jesus and will also raise us in spirit and truth, we remember all who have died and are at peace among the saints. God of grace,
receive our prayer.
Knowing the Holy Spirit intercedes for us, we offer these prayers and the silent prayers of our hearts in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
We share the blessing of Christ's peace. Worship God with our saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." As often as we take of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Jesus, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. You may be seated. Please stand. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen. Let us pray.
Receive the benediction. God who named you, Christ who claims you, and the Holy Spirit who dwells in you, bless you and remain with you always. Amen. Thank you.